Hi, welcome to Rise Up. I'm Don Ennis. I've been a resident of West Hartford for 13 years. I want to tell you a little bit about myself, but first let me tell you what this is all about. This episode is called Forward March, coming as it does right on the heels of the latest demonstration of the power of the people. And as for people, let me tell you a little bit about myself. No, better yet, let me show you.
Welcome to West Hartford. A couple of years ago, they had these cows all over town. I guess they're really bulls because look at the horns. And they were painted, and this one was placed right here in front of West Hartford Town Hall.
So this is also where West Hartford Community TV is located. And while we're here, I'm gonna take you on a little tour of West Hartford. And I hope I can tell you a little bit about me and find out what you'll see if you do visit West Hartford, because I know a lot of you are watching us on YouTube. International Women's Day, I'm wearing my red. And I gotta tell you, I'm a little red in the face about having to tell you my story, because even though I've told it, I don't know how many times, it always sort of begs the question of, is she making this up? Who could have possibly had this kind of life? I was born in New York City, 1964. I'm gonna be 53 this month. And at the age of four, my mom, a stay-at-home mom, wife of a police officer, got word that a friend of hers had enrolled their children in modeling and acting. And so she got my sister, who was just a baby at the time, and myself, headshots, and we started doing modeling and commercials. It's quite a different kind of childhood than most people had. Most kids after school went to Little League or ballet, and I went into New York City to compete to be the next commercial actor or model at JCPenney's. I was pretty successful too. So I did that for, gosh, 12, 13 years. But at the age of about 12, something sort of happens to boys that we all call puberty. You get pimply, they're bodies get more gangly, their voice deepens, you know. And my mother didn't think that was gonna be good for our income. My sister and I were each earning a third of our family income because, I mean, let's face it, they didn't pay civil servants enough back then, nor did they do it now. So my mom hit upon the idea of having me try out for girls' parts. And I did a radio ad, and I did some modeling. But I worked with Sarah Jessica Parker and Brooke Shields, and nobody was the wiser. I did this for 4 or 5 years. And you know what? It was sort of fun. I enjoyed it. I don't know many boys who would. But there was something in me that just made me feel as if, oh, this was just fun with my mom. And I enjoyed the dress up and growing my nails long and, you know, my dad used to always knock me. He wasn't in on it. My mom and I kept it a secret. And he said, paint him or cut him. I wanted to paint him, but instead, I just sort of kept him hidden. I had a Dorothy Hamill haircut. It was different. It was a different kind of existence. At my boys' high school, I got a lot of ribbing. But I found that the joy of being with my mom and being who I could be was worth all the trouble. We would get together after school, we'd drive to New York City to a subway station, I'd change in the back seat of the car, and then we'd go into Manhattan to try out for whatever part it was or for modeling. I'd miss a lot of school, and teachers started to notice, boy, you know, he's missing a lot of school, this kid. And eventually kids started seeing me on TV and in modeling catalogs and things like that. So my mother had to fess up. She never told anyone I was a girl. But again, that stopped when I was about 16. My dad found out. So that was an unpleasant conversation. My dad let me know I was no longer going to be doing that. And I went back to just being a boy. And the hardest part about that was is that I had delayed my puberty through artificial means. I wasn't aware that I was doing it. My mom called them vitamins. I thought they were vitamins. The vitamins came in a clamshell case, and honestly, it was hard. I didn't like having to swallow pills, and I didn't connect the dots until I was about 40 years old that the little pills in the circle in the clamshell case were something other than vitamins. But I stopped taking them at my dad's instruction, and life went on. I went through normal male puberty at age 18. Very hard, very difficult. Because at the age of 5, I had pretty much figured out I'm not like other boys. I didn't like hanging out with other boys. I had one friend who was a boy, and the other boys I didn't really care for. And I liked the girl across the street, and we had fun, and I liked playing with all the things that my sister had. And, you know, I asked my mom once, I said, why am I so different? What is it about me? And she told me I'm special. Well, doesn't every mom tell their child that they're special? But we didn't have a word for it back then. Is I am getting involved in activism and politics and civics and trying to understand how things work. Not just report on them so I can share those stories with you, but to be part of the system and part of the fix and part of the solution instead of part of the problem, which is how many people see journalists today. So we're back at West Hartford Community Television at West Hartford Town Hall. I hope you enjoyed the little tour. And one of the reasons we're back here at Town Hall is because on Tuesday night, there was an incredible gathering at the Board of Ed meeting in which standing room only, big crowd here to hear the budget plan for 2017-2018. And it's not good, folks. We're talking massive cuts. We're talking about millions of dollars that they need to find. And that means larger class sizes. It means fewer employees. It means fewer custodians. It means cutbacks and offerings of certain programs. There are a series of dates coming up. And here are those dates. The dates you see on the screen right now, these are dates in which you can attend a hearing and find out more. And some of these programs will allow you to actually speak out, to express your opinion. For more information, you can go to our website, lifeafterdawn.com, and you will be able to find out more about what is available to you. This is your chance to get involved. Don't just let it happen. Don't just let other people make decisions. You need to get involved. And that's why on Saturday night of the week previous, I went to a neighbor's house. Nearly 60 people packed into this house because they're not happy with the way Congress is run right now, which is run by the Republican Party. And whether you be a Democrat or a Republican, I think it's interesting to pay attention to what kind of grassroots movements are out there. We all followed the Tea Party some years ago, and now something different is lining up in America. This group is called Swing Left. And as you can see from the pictures here, thanks to Mr. John O'Neill for sharing these with us, people are interested in making change. The idea of, in this gathering is to swing the 19th district in New York from red to blue to win over voters so that the 26,000 vote margin that elected a Republican member of Congress, well, in the next election cycle, 2018, the midterms, will turn that district into a Democratic district, thereby, with other districts, changing the balance in Congress from a Republican majority to potentially a Democratic majority. That's what Swing Left is all about. They're trying to get folks to vote Democratic. So they had this gathering to encourage people to step up, and they're going to be going to this area of New York, outside Poughkeepsie, and they're going to try and win over the voters. They don't have a candidate. They just want to try and listen to their issues and make sure they know what the Democrats are all about and what the Republicans are all about. And like I said, I'm not trying to sway anyone watching this one way or the other, but I do want people to be engaged. I do wish people would get involved. I think the only way we can have the government by the people and for the people is if the people rise up. So my plan is that each week I will have a guest correspondent tell you a little bit about why they rise up. This week it's Hannah Simpson. Hannah is someone I've mentored. She is someone who considers me her aunt. someone I consider a friend. And she is a outspoken activist, advocate, and writer. And she's often been on television talking to people about what it is to be transgender. And I think she offers a very interesting perspective in this report. Hannah?
Hi, Dawn. This is Hannah Simpson coming into you from Los Angeles. And I'm really excited to tell you about why I'm rising up, both before and in the wake of the Supreme Court's decision this week on the case of Gavin Grimm. So, the first thing I tell people is that I didn't change my gender. My gender changed me. This is who I always was, and if anything, I consider myself lucky to have had the chance to discover that, to have to work a little bit harder to assert my own femininity and find my place in the world where for some people that wasn't something, that isn't something they have to question. But at this point, I tell people, you know, that my driver's license says female on it, like any other woman's. It doesn't say how long I've been one, that I wasn't always one, or how long or even if I plan to remain one. And I like that a lot of being a woman is living in the moment, and that's what I'm really excited to do, both for myself to exert my fullest possible potential, but also to remind people of where I came from. I try to say it this way, I say that not hiding my past might help somebody else to stop hiding their future, to realize that it's never too late to be the person they were destined to be, to realize that life in a closet is perhaps not life at all. And what I want to tell the youth out there in the work that I do, in the writing that I do, in being on media and in discussing transgender issues over and over and over again with anybody who will listen, whether it's on the internet or in North Carolina, where I was working with Hillary Clinton for the election, on the Democratic campaigns, is simply this, is that when you get to meet someone like me, that I like to think I'm a little bit cuter and a lot harder to deny than whatever hypothetical you have of a transgender person cooked up in your head. And that's beautiful. It's fun, it's engaging, and it's a chance to show people that I'm the person these bathroom bills, like HB2 in North Carolina and SB6 in Texas being discussed and introduced currently, and the case of Gavin Grimm in the Gloucester Public Schools in Virginia, are discussing. It's people like me who just want to get on with our lives, who want to be part of public society and to have so much to offer. Because we're charming, we're engaging, we're intelligent, and we see the beauty in so many different people where others perhaps see barriers, see misconceptions, or don't want to see it all. And I'm here to change that. One person, one discussion, one video, one op-ed at a time. Whatever it takes, because I want to give every transgender youth the exact same opportunity that I want to give every hateful adult in this country. The chance to grow up. The chance to fulfill yourself, to realize your potential, to be part of this world because it's better with you in it. Simply put, legislating peeing is legislating being. This isn't about humans peeing, this is about humans being. This is about understanding the big and beautiful creator that we might have, who wants to make things beautiful and diverse, and the infinite multiplicity that makes me me and me unique from anybody else that is or has ever or will be. And I'm thankful for that. So when I say I believe in God, I believe in myself because I think God created me too. And I want the world to see that, and I want the trans youth out there, those who come in background from backgrounds of faith, those who don't, to realize that you are part of this world, you are yourselves, whoever you think that you are. It's not going to go away, it's not going to pass through your system, it's part of you, and it's beautiful. And I am so lucky to follow in the footsteps of those who came before, those whose tears, sweat, and far too often blood have paved a path that allows me to even explore my potential. And I hope to make that path just a little bit wider, a little bit clearer, and a little less lonely for those who follow. Because at the end of the day, asserting our own and ensuring others' freedom of expression is the greatest expression of freedom there is. This is Hannah Simpson reporting from Los Angeles. Now back to you in the studio, Dawn.
My first guest is Sarah Hembrick. She is a member of the board of the League of Women Voters of Greater Hartford. Welcome, Sarah.
Hello.
And I know you're here representing yourself, not the League, but you have an insight into the League of Women Voters that most of us don't have. Mm-hmm. I don't really know what they do. Can you tell us a little bit about what is the League of Women Voters?
Well, let me give you a little bit of history. I am here just under my own steam, but I'm very happy to be talking about the League. It's a great organization. And it's almost 100 years old, a nonagenarian. It was founded just on the eve of the adoption of the 19th Amendment, which gave women the right to vote. And of course, it was first established to promote women's activities and participation in the public sphere as the women were gaining the right to vote. Then it became sort of a two-pronged effort. We have a very strong focus on education, voter service guides, campaign debates, and we also have a advocacy wing, which promotes the policies that are studied and developed within the League. For example, on matters of the environment, fair housing, reproductive rights, et cetera.
There's sounds like very progressive causes.
Yes, they really are a lot of progressive policies, but the League is careful to always be extremely well-informed, and that's one of the great things about being in the League for me, because it's like getting schooled on a regular basis.
So much today is politicized, and anything that's not pro-Trump seems to be either fake news or branded liberal. Would you say that the League of Women Voters is a liberal organization?
It's very much nonpartisan. But I think the reason that the policies seem to come across as progressive is because of the studying that goes on.
Okay.
Because it's a lot of fact-based, evidence-based information that comes in, and then discussion. And of course, as the world moves on, our sense of social mores changes, and that's what gives it the air of progressivism.
How has the election results impacted the League of Women Voters?
Well, we have had a a sudden uptick in the number of members. I think we have at least 12 people have come forward and joined our membership here.
Since when? Since the election?
Yes, since the election.
And how many do you usually get in a year?
I don't know. I'm not really the best person to know that exactly, but I'm sure it's not that many.
So it's
this is very much more than we usually experience, and we're hopeful that it's going to be even stronger.
So how does one get involved then?
Well, there's three levels of the League: the national, the state, and the local. I'm with the Greater Hartford chapter. So each one of those, of course, has a website. Ours is lwvgh.org. You can go there or to the League of Women Voters of Greater Hartford Facebook and sign up there. You know, let us know. There's contact information there. Or visit a local library. We're trying to get these flyers out so that people can go ahead and just do it the snail mail way.
And it has a website right on it, mm-hmm. lwvgh.org.
Right. And there's also a state level and a national level. When you join a local, you become a member of the state and national by virtue of becoming a local member. In fact, your membership dues that come in, a big portion of it goes to the national.
Well, let's talk about that. It sounds like there's money involved. How much does it cost to be a member?
Well, it's not extremely significant money. It's a pretty good deal. An individual is 60, but a brand new member is only 45.
Okay.
And for a household that's two or more, $75.
And what do you get for that?
Well, you get an avenue for great information, and you get a trusted organization that's, as I said, almost 100 years old, has great gravitas and commitment to advocacy of the issues and voter protections and voter education.
Would you say it's a great way to start getting involved? I think a lot of people are watching the marches and they're seeing protests and demonstrations, and they want to do something, but they're not sure how to find out about information or where it is that these things are organized. What would you recommend?
Well, it is a really good way to get involved. You get a lot of bang for your buck because you get a steady flow of information coming out of your local, state, and national leagues via emails. So you're alerted to all sorts of things that are happening all over the country. So that in and of itself is wonderful. The other thing is, if you're a very busy person and you can't really devote a whole
aren't
lot of time, aren't we all? That's true. The League is a great place because your voice joins the stream of others, and you get more bang for your voice that way. And it doesn't impose a rigorous requirement for you to get very involved. We're grateful for what you can offer, and the more you can get involved, the better. But everybody understands there's phases of our lives where we're very, very much busy with our personal lives or our professional lives, and you can't do it all.
Let me present two spectrum ends. I'm a trans woman. Would I find people who are LGBT friendly at the League of Women Voters?
Undoubtedly. Well, you'd find me. And I haven't found anybody who would be in any way hostile. We're devoted to non-discrimination, so it's totally in keeping with the league. I can't imagine that there would be a problem. I can't speak for everybody on an individual level, but from an organizational standpoint, I've never gotten any hint that you wouldn't be welcomed.
And from the other end, if I was a Republican woman, and once I was a Republican,
mm-hmm. We let them in too.
I was going to ask.
Because it's nonpartisan, of course. A lot of our members are Republican.
That's great. And the idea is that it's a
way... Some from the Working Family Party, too.
That's interesting. Now, how does that relate in terms of, are there fights? Are there people locking heads? I mean,
no.
It must be interesting.
No, at the board meetings or at our events, legislative breakfasts or wine and cheese for the legislators or symposia, no, there's no locking of heads. That's one of the great, great things about the league. In fact, I wanted to be sure to bring this out to your listeners, is there's a commitment to civil discourse that's part of the history of the league. And that's one of the things I worry about what's happening currently. The civility seems to be on the wane. I hope it comes back. But there's a lot of extreme rudeness on all sides.
Sure, those town halls you've seen on television. Mm-hmm. What cause motivates you? Because I told you before that I'm into LGBTQ causes, mm-hmm. but I have a lot of other interests as well. Which one is your most important cause?
Well, I'm very much a proponent in my personal life, this is not a league stance, of the aid in dying legislation.
What's that about?
That assures a terminally ill person who is competent and who has gone through multiple layers of review process that he, she, with only 6 months left to live due to a terminal illness, will be able to end his or her own life by taking a dose of medication.
Is that not the law already in Connecticut?
No, it is not the law in many places, most places, but California recently passed it. Oregon passed it, I think, almost 20 years ago. I think, and there's a handful of other states. I wish I had them at the top of my head. But there's five or six states now with it.
Well, we can link them on our website.
Mm-hmm.
I'm curious. Wasn't it commonly called with Kevorkian assisted suicide?
Well, that's what a lot of its opponents like to call it. And of course, Kevorkian, that was done extra legally. So, mm-hmm. But this is with many built-in protections to make sure nobody's being taken advantage of.
So this is a legal way to terminate your life because it's just not the same quality of life.
Right. And I wanted to mention one other thing that is very much the interest of the league, and that is the national popular vote. Are you familiar with that?
No, please tell us about it.
Okay, this is up for, the aid in dying legislation is up right now in this year's Connecticut legislative session, but so is the national popular vote. This is a compact, it's when a state decides to send its electors to the candidate that receives the highest popular vote.
Hello, we know that.
Right,
we know all about that, don't
because
we?
Right now it's done in such a way that a candidate, and this has happened twice over the last five elections,
yes,
can win without the popular vote.
Well, we just saw
so
that happen.
So this comes much closer to one man, one vote, and hopefully Connecticut legislators will go for it because it'll definitely help our electoral process.
Now, what do you think would happen if Hillary Clinton had lost the popular vote by some small miracle and yet won the Electoral College? Wouldn't this be something that people would be against?
Well, I don't think, I'm not sure that the League of Women Voters has officially adopted this, but I do know that the League of Women Voters has something like 50 times over the last 100 years tried to abolish the Electoral College. The Electoral College does not reflect modernity anymore.
No, it's Alexander Hamilton.
So it needs to be reworked. And most people have this thinking in their heads that the person that gets most votes will become president. So the national popular vote, I mean, maybe it's going to work against my candidate one time and for my candidate the next time, but obviously it's the more sensible way to go.
Do you suspect that in the next 3 years that there will be some kind of action that the League of Women Voters could spur? Is there something happening on a grassroots level that you sense? Because I get a sense that people for the first time are standing up for themselves and they're not wanting to just sit back and watch the news. They want to take to the streets. They want to march. There was a march here in West Hartford. There was a march in Hartford, the march all over the world. Mm-hmm. There are other marches happening. There's a march for science next month in April. All different aspects of our society seem to be saying, let's stand up, let's rise up. What's your perspective on that?
I don't know that the League of Women Voters will be spearheading a rise up kind of campaign, but it's usually one, many of our members are those who are participating in it. But the organization itself is more of a steady and moderate, measured response. Lobbying, testifying at public hearings, that kind of thing.
And from your own perspective, you've been involved?
I've done a lot of marches. I didn't do the one in January.
But, okay.
But I've done my fair share, particularly during the peace movement.
And do you think that these marches are catching on, or is it something that's just going to wane?
I wonder if it's a fad, you know?
I
think it probably is a fad for a lot of people, but we'll see how long it sticks around.
And what's the next thing that happens as far as League of Women Voters? What are they working on right now that you can give us
regionalism? We're studying regionalism for the central Connecticut area.
That's awesome. And I think what's very important is that even though we're in a blue state, as things change in Washington, things can change at the local level too, and all of us have to not take for granted what laws and protections we have, because those decisions that are being made in Washington do impact us here, no matter what our government says.
That's right.
Well, thank you very much, Sarah Hamburg.
Well, thank you very much, Don Ennis. And congratulations on a great show.
And thank you for honoring me by being my first guest.
Oh, I appreciate it.
That's all for this time. Next time, we're going to be joined by the head of the Connecticut branch of the American Civil Liberties Union. There's more information about me and about this show at lifeafterdawn.com. And until next time, I'm Dawn Ennis, and I want to just say in the immortal words of Bruce Springsteen, come on, rise up.